فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So the Shaykh rahimahullah, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, was harmed. And even that though they tried to harm him a lot, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made his da'wah apparent. And the da'wah of the Shaykh spread every place. In a couple of years, the Shaykh's da'wah, it took over Diriyah, and then from Diriyah it spread over the majority of Jaziratul Arab. The Shaykh died, rahimahullah ta'ala, when the year was 1206, and the majority of the Saudi Peninsula, the Arabian Peninsula, was taken by the Shaykh and his students. The only place they didn't have control over was Makkah and Medina. Every other place they took over. Because they entered into Mecca and Medina and they took over ba'da wafati al-shaykh, when the shaykh died. Mecca, Medina, they entered it after he died. And that was when Sa'ud ibn Abdul Aziz ibn Muhammad ibn Sa'ud took over. He's the one who was able to take over Mecca and Medina. The shaykh rahimahullah, from the effects and mashallah, the benefits that came out of his da'wah, was that, of course, that the Amatu Jazirat al-Arabiyah was taken over. The majority of the Arabian Peninsula had now fallen under the banner of Tawheed. Shirk was destroyed, fully eradicated. Also, the Shaykh Rahimahullah, he left behind students of knowledge, Talabatul Ilm. That even if he goes and he dies, His message hasn't died. And this is what he worked towards. He left behind students of knowledge. He left behind people who would carry on the message that the Shaykh was calling to. Now, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to categorize the people in regards to the da'wah of Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. The people in regards to the da'wah of Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, those who rejected his da'wah, are three types. The first ones are the juhal, the ignorant ones. Al-khurafiyuna min awam al-nas. They're from the general mass. They're from the lame people. Those who just blind follow their forefathers. Those who basically repeat what their forefathers have said. Inna wajadna aba'ana ala ummatin wa inna ala atharihim muqtadun. We have found our parents and our forefathers upon this, so we're just going to tread on their path. That's the kind of people you meet. Oh, stay away from Muhammad Abdul Wahhab's da'wah. And that's what many of us might find our parents be. They're just from the juhal. They're just copying and they're pasting what they heard from their forefathers. The second group of people are ta'ifatun tantasibu lil ilm. A group that attribute themselves to knowledge. They rejected and they refuted and debunked the da'wah of the Shaykh, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, not because they are ignorant of it, but they rejected it inadan wa hasadan. They did this out of stubbornness and out of jealousy and envy for the Shaykh. A lot of them, they knew that the Shaykh was calling to the truth and that he was right what he was calling to. But they were scared that the people will say to them, لِمَا لَمْ تُنْكِرْ هَذِهِ الْمُنْكَرَاتِ. Why did, if you guys know that he's right, so why were you silent for all those years for? That question will come to them, so they're scared of it. They knew that the people would say to them, لِمَا لَمْ تُخْبِرُونَ. Why didn't you tell us about these things, about shirk? Why did you guys never tell us about bid'ah? So what did they do? They refuted the da'wah of the Shaykh and they became an obstacle in front of him. And this is where many students of knowledge are like when you call to Tawheed and Sunnah. You fight with shirk and bid'ah, he knows he didn't do that job. He knows he hasn't fulfilled that job. So for no other reason, he's your enemy. Because the people are going to look at him and say, he saw this mistake, he saw what was wrong, he saw that, why haven't you told us this? So he's going to become your aladdu adaik, from the greatest of your enemy. He's your staunch enemy, your mortal enemy. He wants you to go, he wants you to die. That's his goal, that's his objective. Your existence doesn't please him. Are we all together? But why is it that he hates you? Because he realized that his da'wah is fashion. His da'wah is what? Fashion. Corrupt. It hasn't worked. It hasn't reached anywhere. And the da'wah of the tawheed and the sunnah is spreading. Look how it's growing. It's just becoming stronger and stronger and stronger, right? He knows that he could have done that. But you know what his da'wah was? His da'wah was to please the people. So he wasn't telling the people about shirk and bid'ah. He was just pleasing the people. He was telling the people what they want to hear. But he little did he know that if he told the people the truth, that some of the people are going to take it. But some people are in love with the truth. If they see the truth being brought to them, even if it goes against their desires, some people, alhamdulillah, khair is still in them. They're going to still go with you. The third type of people are ta'ifa adat al-shaykh bismi al-siyasa. A group of people are those who showed enmity to the da'wah of the shaykh with the name of politics. And these are the leaders, of course. And those in charge, they showed hate towards the shaykh. Why? Because they were told to this by their, first of all, the ulama is-su, the evil scholars that were around them. The evil scholars around them were telling them this and were saying this to them. And they were beautifying the batil for them. And they were eating the people's, these ulama is-su were eating people's money. And even these leaders as well. So they realized if the shaykh comes with this da'wah, he might pull you guys away from the people. And you guys may no longer be the leaders anymore. And the people may not come to you guys. So what did they do? So they showed enmity and hate to the sheikh and to his da'wah. That's what the people are in regards to the sheikh's da'wah. Some of you may ask yourself and say, okay, question. Wasn't there at the time of the sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and even before him, weren't there other people who were calling to Tawheed and Sunnah? Weren't there? And if there were others who were calling to Tawheed and Sunnah, why is it that only he seemed to be apparent? And he became the upper hand. The response to that question is, first of all, he was not the only person who called to Tawheed and Sunnah. There were other famous scholars who did. From them is Muhammad Amir al-San'ani, whose book we studied a couple of years ago, his kitab Tatir al-I'tiqad, where he talks about purifying people's beliefs. If you read that book, he fights against shirk and he fights against khurafat and bid'ah and dalalat. Muhammad Amir al-San'ani. He was a muwahid, he was from Yemen, from scholars of Yemen. Also from those scholars from Yemen again is Hussein al-Nu'mi, Hussein ibn Nu'mi, rahimahullah. Was from the great scholars of Yemen as well. He was also at the time of the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala. Okay? He also was from the scholars who called to Tawheed. He called to Sunnah, fought against Shirk and Dalalat. But there was a reason why their da'wah, even though it was upon the same da'wah as the Shaykh, they didn't get intishar. The da'wah didn't spread. The first reason is, the Shaykh rahimahullah, he received. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he received and he gained a people who give victory to his da'wah. Na'am, so the Shaykh rahimahullah, he received aid and physical support. This is a distinction between him and the da'wah of Amir al-San'ani, Muhammad Amir al-San'ani, and the da'wah of Al-Imam Hussein al-Nu'mi rahimahullah. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said something very powerful. He said, هذا الدين لا يقوم. This religion doesn't stand إلا على كتاب, except with a book يهدي, that guides, وسيف ينصر, and a sword that gives victory to it. And what the Shaykh means by ibn Taymiyyah means by sword here is laws have to have application and consequences if you go against it. If you go for a red light right now, It's not just if you go through a red light, you can't go through a red light. That's not all it is. There's consequences. The consequences here is what? You get points on your license. You also have to pay a fine. So every law has to have somebody who's out there, who's able to execute it. So Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Abdul Wahab, when he commanded people things, if he didn't do it or if it wasn't done, there was consequences. His da'wah had consequences. Muhammad Amir al-Sana'ali didn't have that. Nor did Hussein al-Nu'mi. The second is عَدَمُ الصَّبْرِ كَثِيرٍ مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ الَّذِينَ كَانَ عِنْدَهُمْ. Majority of the people who were with these other ulama, Amir al-Sana'ani and Hussein al-Nu'mi, they didn't show patience. Patience wasn't shown. A lot of these people didn't show patience. But Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he showed patience on the harm of the people. After everything that happened, he showed patience. Even today, what do you see? A group of people who are doing da'wah ila Allah, al-amru bil ma'roof wa nahi anil munkar, and you always find a group of people who pull out on them. Say, oh, I'm not part of this. Especially when the pressure comes and the heat comes. They pull out, they walk away. They think that that's a better path. Like in Al-Majd, Izzaka doesn't come to you like that. Honor will come to you in enduring this pain that's coming. This hardship that you're being put through. The criticism and the name calling and the accusations that are being thrown at you. Show patience, bear it, forbearance. I promise you, it will not, these people's accusation, history may not even remember it. It may not even be documented. It may not even be mentioned. Do we know all of the people who harmed Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Abdul Wahab? Majority of us have to search deep the names of those people if you want to know who they are. You won't find them. You struggle to find them if you do find them. The reason is because Allah said in the Quran, فَأَمَّا الزَّبَدُ فَيَذْهَبُ جُفَاءً. The foam, the thing that doesn't benefit, it will go. وَأَمَّا مَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسَ فَيَبْكُثُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. What will benefit the people, Allah said, will remain. The person who is beneficial for the people, he will remain, he will stay. And the person who is not beneficial for the people, he may sometimes come up and seem to be, but he will go. He'll go and he will perish and he will no longer be mentioned. لَا يُذْكَرْ. No one will speak about him and no one will mention him. So sabr and patience is what the Shaykh showed. And as we all know, with patience and certainty comes what? Leadership. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah used to say, بِالصَّبْرِ وَالْيَقِينِ تُلَالُ الْإِمَامَةَ فِي الدِّينِ. With patience and certainty, a person will reach leadership. And that's from the Qur'an, by the way. Allah said in the Qur'an, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. Allah says, we made them leaders, Banu Israel. We made them leaders. But we made them leaders when they came with two characteristics, when they were patient and when they showed certainty. Patience in all of the hardship that was thrown at them, all of the calamities that they were afflicted with, they showed patience to it. And also they showed the patience and they showed certainty in the promises Allah has given them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believed Allah is going to give victory to the righteous people. They knew إِنَّ نَصَرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. That Allah's victory is close to the righteous ones and the good doers. They knew that this Qur'an held the good of this world and the hereafter. They knew the prosperity of every individual is connected in the Qur'an and the Sunnah. That certainty that he shows is what Allah is going to give them a victory on. The third reason why many of these people who according to Tawheed, they never reached far is because some of them, their knowledge was very weak. The Shaykh's knowledge was very vast, very strong and very grounded. Especially when it came to defending and deflecting the doubts that they brought. These people bring doubts. They won't just leave you to call you to your Tawheed and your Sunnah. They'll come out and what will they do? What are they going to do? They're going to make sure that they throw doubt and shubuhat regarding your da'wah. So Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, what did he do? What did he do? He had answers for all the doubts that they brought. He responded to all of it. He wrote a whole kitab that they were not able to respond to, which is Kashfu Shubuhat, removing the doubts that they brought forward. That's the whole book. It's about the doubts that they opened on his book, Kitab al-Tawheed. They read it, they, doubts. He got Kitab Kashfu Shubuhat for it, which we're going to study, which is a response and the debunking of the Shaykh in their what? In their doubts. Inshallah ta'ala, we're now going to take lessons that we can benefit from the biography of the Shaykh. What is it that we benefit from him? Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, what we benefit from it is, number one, that the da'wah of the Shaykh's calling is an example that shows us the correct way of bringing a da'wah, or is the correct way of bringing an Islamic dawla, an Islamic government. As we saw in the life of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, that the da'wah doesn't start with perfecting the leaders, no. And not arguing with the leaders. It doesn't. Rather, it starts with speaking against shirk, and it starts with speaking against bid'ah and muhdathat. And the da'wah of the Shaykh also didn't show us that it starts with speaking about politics and parliaments. The Shaykh's da'wah was mabniyun, it was built upon islahi aqa'id al-nas, correcting the people's aqeedah, the people's religion, honoring and venerating, glorifying the book of Allah and the sunnah, honoring the evidences, following the path of the salaf. That is what Allah told us that He's going to give us victory on. قَالَ تَعَالَى Allah said in Surah Muhammad, Ayah 7, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Those of you who believe, in تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ If you give victory to Allah, يَنْصُرْكُمْ Allah will give victory to you guys. وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ And Allah will make your foot grounded and solidified. What does it mean giving victory to Allah? It means following his kitab, following the sunnah, understanding on how the pious predecessors understood it. Also Allah said in Surah Hajj, Ayah 40, وَلَا يَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ Allah says in this verse, Allah is going to give victory to the one who gives victory to Allah's religion, to Allah's book, to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Allah describes for us the characteristics of those who are going to attain victory. Allah tells us, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ They're the ones, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ They're the ones who, when we make them grounded on this earth, أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ They establish the prayer. وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةِ They give zakat. وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ They call to the good. وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ And they prohibit the evil. وَلِلَّهِ عَقِبَةُ الْأُمُورِ And the final ending of everything is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is the greatest amr that the Anbiya came with? أَعْظَمُ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ What is the greatest thing Allah commanded? What is the greatest thing that the Anbiya and the Rasul called to? What was the greatest good that they called to? At-Tawheed. What is the greatest evil that Allah prohibited? And the messengers and the prophets warned against? Ash-Shirku. So when the ayah says, وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ They call to the good. The biggest good to call to is what? At-Tawheed. And they prohibited munkar. What is the greatest form of munkar that a person needs to prohibit? Ash-Shirku. It is Ash-Shirku. And this is what prophets and messengers warned against. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he knew that. Also Allah says in another ayah, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ Allah makes a promise and an oath. That the believing one from amongst us, those who believe in Allah and have come with righteous actions, لا يستخلفنهم في الأرض. Allah is going to make us governors on this earth. Allah is going to place authorities and control into our hands. كما استخلف الذين من قبلهم, like he has done for those who came before us. وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to solidify them on the religion which he has become pleased for them. وَلَيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا. And Allah is going to change for them the fear that they were in. Allah is going to bring them safety from it. What is it that's needed from them? يَعْبُدُونَنِي, they will worship me. لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا, and they don't associate partners with me. Allah said, I'll do all of that for you guys. I'll make you governors on this earth. I'll place authority in your hands. I will make you guys grounded. Power and strength will be in your hand. But يَعْبُدُونَنِي, you're going to worship me alone. You're going to worship me alone. لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا, and you're not going to associate any partners with me. This is called شَرْطُ التَّمْكِينَ. This is called شَرْطُ التَّمْكِينَ. The condition for what? For Allah to make us grounded on this earth. وَالِاسْتِخْلَافِ, Allah making us governors. The condition for it is what, sisters and brothers? Tawheed. توحيد الله, singling Allah in worship. وتطهير الاعتقاد, and perfect العقيدة. That is the first lesson that we take from Hajj Abdul Wahab's biography. The Ummah will not be uplifted. لا يتم النهوض. The Ummah will not be lifted. لا يتم النهوض. لا يتم النهوض. The Ummah will not be lifted, and it will not be raised. إلا عبر هذا الطريق, except through his path of calling to Tawheed and warning against shirk. الشيخ محمد بن عبد الوهاب, if you guys read his رسائل, his works, you will realize that he even had distinct things that he surpassed even Ibn Taymiyyah. Things that he even surpassed Ibn Taymiyyah on. He even surpassed Ibn al-Qayyim on. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. And what is that? It's the following three things. Number one, Ibn Abdul Wahab, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab, he busied himself with Aslul Usul. Muhammad ibn Abdul didn't talk about sub branches and other, he talked about the usul. He made sure that he spoke about the usul. Good. Whereas Ibn Taymiyyah, you see him talk about usul and he talks about furu'. And Ibn Qayyim is the same. Muhammad ibn Abdul, he gave all of his efforts, all of his hard work, just to aslu usul. And when you put your effort into all of it in one thing, you produce strength in that one thing. The second is the Shaykh's works and his da'wah. لم تكن خاصة لطالبة العلم. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab, his da'wah and his works are not written for students of knowledge. He is written for the Ammatul Nas as well, the general mass. If you go to some of his books, if you go to some of his works and some of his books, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab even speaks Amiya. He doesn't even speak the formal Arabic in some of his rasail. Are you with me? He drops the language caliber low for the people. And when he's speaking to them, he talks to them in the language they understand. Some of his rasail are not even in formal Arabic. And this is him following what? بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ. بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ, speaking to the people, the language that they understand. For example, you say, يَوْمَ جَانَا. جَانَا, it means a جَانَا. The Shaykh wouldn't speak like that, formal like that. He would say, يَوْمَ جَانَا مِنْكَ كِتَاب فُلَان وَفُلَان مَثَلًا. And he would use that type of language which the people speak. Ibn Taymiyyah, on the other hand, you need a dictionary next to you when you're reading his works. Ibn al-Qayyim, the same, you need dictionary. They use very technical terms. He wasn't like that. So this is what's unique about Muhammad Abdul Wahhab. Number three is, he got and he received somebody who's going to give him victory, of course. Huh? Ibn Taymiyyah, no one was helping him in his da'wah. He was alone. No government was aiding him. Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, lakin, he received what? Nasr, a victory from a leader who supported and aided him in his da'wah. The second benefit that we take from the life of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab is the effect that knowledge has, and the spreading of knowledge, the way that it raises the ummah. And we also learn in that same point, we learn the position that the scholar holds and the effect that an alim has. Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did not have soldiers. He did not have an army. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did not make a jama'ah. He didn't make a jama'ah. Muhammad Abdul did not make a jama'ah. And he did not make a hazab, a group. And we say, we're hizb fulan, or we're hizb this. He didn't. Rather, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab alone, what he produced, ahzabs, not one, but ahzabs haven't produced it. Ahzab haven't produced that. Groups, sects haven't produced what one man by himself did. And this shows us manzilatul alim, this position that a scholar by himself can do, and what he can bring about. And that we need to know, if we want to be raised, if we want to go up, that we will never go up بغير العلم والعلماء, without knowledge and the scholars. That's why Allah said in the Quran, إن إبراهيم كان أمة. Ibrahim alone was an ummah. قانتا لله حنيفا ولم يكن من المشركين. Ibrahim by himself was a what? Was an ummah. Because he was an alim, he was a nabi min anbiya illahi ta'ala. By himself, Ibrahim. And Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he alone was an ummah. He had a whole, it was like he had a whole nation with him. In his own da'wah, by himself, what he was producing. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. So we don't need At-tanzimat, groups. We don't need that. It's enough for us to everybody to spread Tawheed. I don't have to know every da'i that calls to da'wah Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah. I don't need to know that. It can be in any place of the world. What will unite us is our da'wah, right? Sometimes the du'a, they spend too much time meeting and sitting together and getting to know each other. Who are the three prominent scholars? Who are the three prominent scholars whose names always mentioned next to each other? Ibn Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, and Sheikh Nasir, rahimahullah, Sheikh Albani. Do you think they met each other very often? Ibn Uthaymeen and Albani only met each other twice. Their whole life, they only met each other twice. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, even when they asked him about Albani, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, he said, I only met him twice. It was very little. Albani said, I vaguely remember him when I met him. Rahimahullah. They didn't have this long-term relationship where they talked and they called each other, they conversed, none of that. Every man from his town, his village, if he spreads Tawheed and Sunnah, that is what unites us both. That's what brings us together. We don't need to have an umbrella that we all go to, because that organized projects and programs, it weakens things. What does it do? It weakens things. So we don't need that. If you look at Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, did he make a group? Did Ibn Taymiyyah have an organization? Taymiyyah organization. He didn't have none of that. Rahimahullah. La, he didn't have no jama'ah. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. He had no He had no jama'ah. Ibn al-Qayyim didn't. La Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Kathir and others, they didn't have that. All they were calling to was a da'wah based upon al-tariqatu al-salafiyyah. Ala manhaj ahli sunnati wal jama'ah. According to the methodology of ahli sunnati wal jama'ah. The third benefit that we take from the biography of the Shaykh is the importance of perfecting the people's aqeedah and starting with that, giving that the first priority. The Shaykh did not discuss and argue and debate on matters that were sub-branches. He focused on Aslul Islam wa Mabanih. He busied himself with the foundations of Al-Islam and that which is built on. He didn't go into khilaf fiqhi. Where do you put your hand? Can you move your finger? Should you go down on your knees first? He didn't go into any of that. The Shaykh rahimahullah, his argument was Aslul Usul, La ilaha illallah, what does it mean? ولذلك الشيخ عبد اللطيف ابن عبد الرحمن ابن حسن ابن محمد ابن عبد الوهاب he said وأما القتال فلم يقاتل الشيخ he said as for fighting he said the Shaykh بن محمد عبد الوهاب he did not fight إلا على أصل الإسلام he only fought on the foundations of Islam والتزام مبانيه العظام and sticking and holding on to the fundamentals of this great religion. وَمَنْ نَقَلَ عَنْهُ Anyone who transmits from him أَنَّهُ قَاتَلَ عَلَى غَيْرِ ذَلِكَ That he fought on anything other than that. فَقَدْ كَذَبَ وَافْتَرَى He has lied and he has forged a statement against the Shaykh. So this is what the Shaykh rahimahullah was making sure that he called to. And that has allowed him to be what? Successful in his da'wah. If you look at today, Al-Hizb al-Ikhwan, you look at Hizb al-Tabligh, you look at Hizb al-Tahrir, and other than them, do they give importance to this issue? Aslul Usul? Do they give importance to Tawheed La ilaha illallah? Wallahi, they don't. They don't give importance to that. Rather, what they are more concerned about is the unity of the people's words and the people holding hands. They were not in any way, form or shape concerned about Tawheed of the Kalimatu La ilaha illallah and the Sunnah. The fourth benefit that we take, benefit that we derive from the Shaykh's life is Ahmiyatu Sabri fil Ilm. How it's important to be patient in knowledge and in da'wah. And to be patient until you fulfill your goal. وَالظَّفَرِ فِي الْمَطْلُوبِ And you're patient until you attain what you want to attain. Wallah, you see people start da'wah projects. You see people start calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they only do it for a year or two. And after that they're tired, they stop doing it. Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اصْبِرُوا Those of you who believe, be patient. اصْبِرُوا وَصَابِرُوا وَرَابِطُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ Be patient. There's no success except with patience. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَا أُعْطِيَ أَحَدٌ عَطَاءً خَيْرٌ وَأَوْسَعٌ مِنَ الصَّبْرِ That a person has not been given anything greater and more vast than patience. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he showed a lot of patience. And through the patience, the Shaykh rahimahullah, he achieved a lot. Last but not least, is the benefit that we take from it, is that Allah can bring al-tamkeen, al-izzah, al-nasr, al-ta'yid. Allah can bring victory. And he can bring support and aid. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you victory. Bima laysa fi husbani du'at. In places that we du'at can never think of. Allah can bring victory in places that we were not assuming, in places that we thought it won't come from. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can bring it. And Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab's life is a prime example for that. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after him leaving and walking away from his town, his birth, his place of birth, Uyayna, coming to a place where he doesn't know air, he doesn't know what to expect and what they're going to say to him. And he's walking, he doesn't know where to go. At that particular moment, a lot of us would have thought that never would victory come like this. But victory can come from places we never thought. And we never assumed, and it never came to our minds. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He conditioned that we stick to His religion and that He's going to bring victory from that. We all know the story of Hudaybiyah, Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He referred to this as a fatah, an opening. When if you look at it from the apparent, what was taking place at that moment, it didn't look like it was an opening. But it shows how little we know and how vast Allah's knowledge is. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brought victory for the believers. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. I said before the fifth one was going to be the last one, but this is going to be the last one. The effect that the religion spreading it through knowledge has in what it leaves behind and the people in which it produces. This is something powerful. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab might have gone. He might have left. But he left off a dhurriya, a lineage. Ila yawmina hadha, till today, they're still alive. Ala shaykh, they're called. Ala shaykh is what they're called. They're still alive. Ila yawmina hadha. He left this behind. Their knowledge is what we benefit from. We read the shuruhat. And one of the best explanations of Sheikh Salih Al Sheikh, Sheikh Abdul Aziz, the Mufti now, Sheikh Abdul Aziz Al Sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, who is the grandfather of who? Salah, Sheikh Salah, who is the wazir. We have Hussein Al Sheikh. We have all of these grandchildren that have come from the Sheikh. We have, before that, we have Abdul Rahman. We have Abdul Rahman, who is the grandson of the Shaykh Rahimahullah Ta'ala, Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan. We have Abdul Latif, who is the son of Abdul Rahman. We have Muhammad ibn Ibrahim ibn Abdul Latif. We have Salih ibn Abdul Aziz ibn Muhammad ibn Ibrahim ibn Abdul Latif ibn Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. These are prominent scholars. Was still alive, but Sheikh Salah is alive. And Sheikh Muhammad Ibrahim was the Mufti before Sheikh Ibn Baz. These are from those are the lineage of the Sheikh. What about the students that came from his madrasa? The students that came from his madrasa, like Sheikh Al-Bani rahimahullah, Sheikh Abd Aziz Ibn Baz, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, Sheikh Salah Al-Fawzan, Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbad. These ulama, Sheikh Safir Rahman Warkafuri from India, and Hadith Wala Haraj. The Sheikh's da'wah, it went ala mashariq al-ardi, ala mashariq al-ardi wa magharibiha, the east and the west. And wherever you go in the world, his books are taught and his works are studied. Anything which I have said that was wrong while speaking about the biography of the Sheikh is from me, Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليه